I've received a couple of requests to share my thoughts on communism. For those who may not be interested in watching past my introduction, I think that communism is a dangerously empty promise based on lies. It fails every time that it's tried, and many millions of people have died directly because of communism. For those interested in learning more, though, I've done a lot of research into communism. Let me share the history of communism with you, and why it's doomed to always fail, because I have some opinions on the subject. Back in 1835, a teenager named Karl Marx began his college education at the University of Bonn. It took him just 6 years to earn a PhD in philosophy, although he left the University of Bonn after just a year there to complete his studies at the University of Berlin and then submitted his doctoral thesis to the University of Jena without attending a single class there because of their far more liberal policies. Marx wanted an academic career, but after years of what was considered scandalous behavior, that just wasn't going to happen. Instead, he started writing for a series of newspapers. Based on the socialist ideas and heavy criticism of the Prussian government, in particular, that those papers published, they had a tendency to get shut down or to otherwise fail. And Marx had a similar tendency to get expelled from whatever country in which he was living, eventually settling in London. Being a failed academic and intermittently published journalist really didn't pay very well, and Marx needed a financial sponsor. In 1844, he found one in Friedrich Engels, the son of a prominent textile industrialist. Engels had withdrawn from high school and only attended some lectures at the University of Berlin, but through his father, he had access to well-paid employment. Engels occasionally wrote under pseudonyms for the papers where Marx was editor, attempting to keep his ties to his prominent father hidden. This set up a pattern for both Marx and Engels of publishing anonymously or under pseudonyms, even making sure that the several houses that they used were owned under fake names in order to avoid the official surveillance that both of these men attracted. In 1848, Marx and Engels wrote the Communist Manifesto. It starts with the claim that communism is already a power in European politics. At the time the manifesto was written, in fact, the term communism was only about 8 years old. Marx and Engels had already been publishing articles in support of communism by that time, just as Thomas Jefferson can be considered a founding father of the United States in part because of his authorship of the Declaration of Independence, so too Marx and Engels can be considered founding fathers of the Communist Party because of their authorship of the Communist Manifesto. The tone of the manifesto was likely shaped by the 1848 revolutions in Europe. These revolutions were against the aristocracy, who lumped together supporters of democracy, liberalism, nationalism, and socialism into one group they called radicals. Communism was at the time merely a splinter faction of socialism, not a core group as presented in the manifesto. The uprisings began in the spring and by fall had secured significant gains in France, Italy, what would later become Germany, and the Austrian Empire. But by 1849, the revolutions had been suppressed everywhere but in France, which had formed the short-lived Second Republic. Nowhere did communism gain control, and in most places, the Communist Party didn't even have a seat at the table. The manifesto argues that communism is an ancient idea. I've looked at the source materials which Marx cited, and in fact, there are several ideas later incorporated into communist thought found in history, from ancient Greece through to the 1848 revolutions. Owning property in common is an old concept developed initially during the feudal period and further developed during the Radical Reformation. Egalitarianism, the concept that all members of the community are equal instead of divided into social classes, rose to prominence under John Locke more than 100 years before Marx. Here's the problem, though. Marx claimed that communism has always existed ever since people were hunter-gatherers. He claimed that communism was, in fact, the default state of human society. It's not. Communism is supposed to be a classless society. Hierarchy is technically not a part of a communist society, and yet, even communalist societies like the religious groups descended from the Anabaptists have a hierarchy. Communism is supposed to be free from capitalism, from each according to his ability, to each according to his need, right? Except that no communist state or society is ever able to fully abandon trade with outside groups. In fact, the dirty little secret of every communist state is that they are always dependent on capitalism to continue functioning. When the capitalist states stop trading with them, the communist states fall behind in technology, in basic services, and especially in food. You see, no true communist society has ever been formed. I mentioned the Anabaptist sects before, and you may recognize them by other names. The Amish, the Hutterites, the Mennonites, and so on. They come as close as anyone ever has to having a functioning communist society, but they aren't communist. There is a distinct hierarchy of leadership. They all trade with the outside world to obtain those things which they cannot produce for themselves. Yes, inside their societies they work together, and yes, to some measure their property is held in common. But they haven't abandoned religion in favor of loyalty to the group. In fact, the reason that their groups were formed in the first place, and the sole reason why they maintain their separatist society, is because of their religious faith. These communities are insular. Communism has a core tenet that it must spread all over the world, displacing every other form of government, every religion, and every other economic system. The Hutterites, who come as close as any group to forming a truly communist society, want none of these things. They accept the doctrine of worldly separation and have a patriarchal society and practice strict pacifism. The Hutterites are not communists, and so far as I've been able to find, they come the closest to forming a communist society without the Communist Party. Communism, as we know it today, is based not on any ancient principles, but on the writings of Marx. Some have said that the communism in the manifesto is Marxism, not communism in general. It is Marxism, yes, but Marxism is just another name for baseline communism and is used properly to distinguish between it and later versions like Leninism and Maoism, where the baseline theory of communism is adjusted to support the rise of various communist states. Communism isn't just a style of living. It's a complex economic, social, and political theory which falsely claims to be the default state of humanity, rejects anything which might divide loyalty to the Communist Party, and desires to conquer the world. That's what makes the manifesto the baseline for communism. It's a political movement, too, unlike any other supposedly communist movement. It's utopian, in that it espouses a stateless, classless, cashless society, but it also requires that a period of socialism must be instituted before the ideal communist society can be created. And as for that socialist transition period? Well, look for yourself. In history, no socialist state ever transitions to a communist society, because those in power don't want to give up that power. In every state where socialism is enacted by a communist party, the economy collapses and famine results. Freedom of thought is impossible. The family unit becomes a source of divided loyalty, so children are encouraged to denounce their siblings, their parents, their grandparents, and even their friends for a lack of patriotism to the communist ideal. There are always purges in these supposedly egalitarian states. There is always a loss of expertise, as intellectuals are purged, either to be re-educated or just to be disappeared. These things always happen, and without outside support, the communist state always collapses. Of course, since those states never transition from socialism to communism, the supporters of communism will quickly and accurately point out that they weren't really communists in the first place. The utopian ideal of communism is completely unsustainable. It proceeds from false premises. Its supporters deny a century or more of evidence that the transition from a socialist state to a communist society just never happens, and insist that if it's just done the, quote, right way, unquote, that communism will work. It's been over 170 years since the publication of the Manifesto by Marx and Engels, and in that time, the many attempts to create a communist utopia have killed hundreds of millions of people. Mao's policies killed at least 65 million people by themselves. The Soviet Union, at least 20 million people. And that toll is still rising. In China, the Uyghurs are dying in concentration camps right now. In Venezuela, a country which used to be food independent and a net agricultural exporter, currently experiences massive shortfalls in food, medicine, and other basic supplies which it used to export. In fact, Venezuela cannot even keep the lights on right now, experiencing blackouts in 70% of the country, not to mention shortages of gasoline and diesel fuel, and Venezuela is sitting on one of the largest petroleum reserves in the world. In North Korea, such a massive lockdown on communications is in effect that we can only guess how many have died. But we've known about the famines that have been happening in North Korea for many, many years. The Western world's been sending them food convoys to try to keep at least some of the people in North Korea alive for decades. This is why you will never hear me praising communism, not even as a utopian theory. It's why you will never hear me supporting socialism, and why you will often hear me criticizing proposals like universal basic income, universal government medicine, and other socialist policies. The best way to maintain a functioning economy is to minimize government regulation and reduce taxes. The best way to prevent the increase in wealth inequality is to keep the labor market tight so that employers have to compete for employees. Stop telling kids that the only way for them to succeed is to go to college, and honestly point out how they can earn a good living in the trades. Stop telling people what they can talk about in public forums and start having conversations with them instead. Communism really doesn't work, and for the life of me, I don't understand why anybody would be supporting it.